Immigration Minister Kris Faafoi says a review of the skilled migrant program is one of his priorities this parliamentary term. Australia is holding an inquiry into its skilled migration program, and in New Zealand, expressions of interest under the category are currently suspended. Kris Faafoi is with us. Tēnā koe. Welcome to Q&A. What does that actually mean?
So anyone who's on a skilled migrant category visa are here on a temporary work visa. Depending on if they've got a job opportunity, they do have a pathway to get residence. So that is what we call an expression of interest process. We halted that process back in April of last year, essentially because of the situation at the borders. Now, we can't look at any applications that are from overseas because the border is closed. And the capacity of processing, and they are involved processes, has been taken largely up by staff who are looking at the exception and exemption process for people who want to come into COVID at the moment. So there's a degree of the legislation that we've passed has caused issues for people offshore, but also the processing of work for people who are coming in under COVID conditions has taken up a lot of the capacity of people who would normally process some of those expressions of interest.
So even before COVID-19, the processing time for some of those skilled migrant visas was really long. I mean, you hear about delays of up to 2 years. Why was that?
Yeah, because I think there were many more applications than were expected. And I think one of the things that we will look at as part of the review is, have we got the settings right? I've openly talked about a rump of applications that come in at the lower end of the criteria and how we deal with those. Because I think, and having listened to some of the comments from the panellists earlier in the show, we need to start thinking about long-term, what kind of skills we have here, what kind of skills we do need here, and where the threshold for that is, and as to who we might bring in, that to start as temporary work, but also to have a pathway to residence.
But do you only want skilled workers?
No, that's only one of the pathways to come into New Zealand. If you ask any business or sector at the moment, of course they want skilled workers, but the ability to do that is extremely limited. But again, as some of your panellists have said, we've got an opportunity here with COVID to have a look at the long-term settings for our immigration system. Quite timely that a review for the SMC was coming up, and we'll undertake that process.
Okay, so you're reviewing the skilled migrant visas. What about people who come here on temporary visas and student visas as well?
Look, that's obviously very difficult at the moment. And again, I think we have to look, as my predecessor had talked about the long-term immigration system and thinking about high-quality immigration system.
What does high-quality mean, though?
Well, it means how do we get the most effective puff of wind for New Zealand out of our economy and also for our communities? You know, some of the panellists have talked about, do we look after migrants well enough? Well, if we're landing them here on student visas but their experience isn't good in terms of migrant exploitation, are we doing them a good turn by having the settings where they are? Are we putting extra pressure on infrastructure, on housing, by having the settings where they are? And again, I think, as well as doing the SMC review, having a moment of pause while the border is closed gives us an opportunity to think about the immigration system transitioning out of where we are at the moment, but also 10, 15, 20 years ahead, not just with business, but also communities, because I think it's also important how, when we bring people here, how they land and how we look after them as well.
There are economic impacts and there are social impacts.
Yeah.
What are your officials telling you about what will happen to demand from people who want to move to New Zealand once the borders reopen and once we're past the immediacy of COVID-19?
Look, there's an assumption that it will increase, and I think there's some validity in that. But demand for how long is the question. I think we'll probably get a post-COVID bump in interest, and we would like to see a post-COVID bump in interest from people who want to invest in New Zealand and bring both resources and create jobs here in New Zealand. But if you think you look further out, 10, 15, 20 years, you know, some of the nations that have fed our migrant workforce, their populations are going to decrease as well. So our ability to get people in to do some of those jobs is going to be made even harder. And one of the things that we want to make sure that we're doing with an immigration system, especially with skills, is that we also take the opportunity to deal with some generational domestic issues. You know, Māori and Pacifica are far too overrepresented in low-skilled, low-wage work. What are we doing to make sure that we are taking an opportunity to upskill them, to make sure that they're earning good wages, as well as looking at the extra capacity that immigration, which has traditionally been a way of filling skill shortages, can assist there too?
Are high net worth individuals actually good immigrants?
Look, it depends on what they bring and the sustainability of their investment. You know, someone can bring in, you know, a big wad of millions of dollars and then be gone and not create any jobs. It really is keeping an eye on what they do and the jobs and sustainability of those jobs in the future. And, you know, that's what Stuart Nash, as Minister of Economic Development, is looking at in terms of some of the investor strategy work that he's doing.
Do you feel comfortable about being in a country where essentially high net worth individuals can buy citizenship?
No, and that's not what we're doing. But I do think that there's going to be added interest in New Zealand, and we're seeing it already.
Would Peter Thiel agree?
Well, that wasn't our government. That was a separate government, so we won't go there. But we think there is an opportunity here post-COVID to say, OK, if there's sustainable investment here that can create jobs, we should take that opportunity. But then I think also when you're talking to sectors or individual businesses who have traditionally relied on migrant labour, we need to have a conversation about them, about their long-term growth plans, to see what their skills needs are, what we can do to make sure we max out the opportunities for New Zealanders, and also a transition post-COVID, but also what immigration looks like for them in 10, 15, 20 years.
Minister Faafoi, thank you very much. You can